श्रीमती रामा जय नमः। एक्चुअली टुडेज टॉपिक इज एन इंटेलेक्चुअल स्ट्रेन एंड लोड टू मोस्ट ऑफ द स्टूडेंट्स एज वेल एज द मास्टर्स, बिकॉज टू मास्टरी अ सिंगल फैकल्टी आर ए डायमेंशनल स्टडी ऑफ वाइड स्प्रेड फैकल्टी, इट रिक्वायर्स आर्डुअस टास्क एंड हेरकुलियन एक्सरसाइजेस, एंड टू हैव ए मास्टरी विच इज नथिंग बट स्टडी ऑफ कन्वर्जेंस ऑफ फोर डिफरेंट फैकल्टीज ऑफ सटल्टी, सटल्टी in promulgative wisdom is known as information technology, and subtlety in the foundations of life factors is biotechnology, and subtlety of the so called particles or matters of existence and actions that are included in nanotechnology, and the subtle force which makes the person to analyze, to design, to direct and to dedicate, to devise the systems as well as the tools for understanding this is cognitive technology. So it is just like asking a student to write all the examinations of botany, zoology, chemistry and physics on the same date, or giving all the questions in the same question paper. So to understand the convergence, even though just we can give a formal basic introduction by which we can realize how a convergence is possible on selective or application oriented fields, still it is a very great brainstorming and mind boggling discussion. Still lot of people, they know about cognition, the word to cognize, to recognize, these words are very commonly used in the routine vocabulary. And what is the role of cognition, number one? What is cognition science, number two? If there is cognition science, what is cognition technology or cognotechnology or cognitive technology, number three? Number four, what is that type of cognitive technology in which independent handling of wisdom of a human being that has been mentioned in our scriptures, number four? Number five, what is the conventional NBIC convergence which they are trying to plan or which they are trying to implement, just as they are in the threshold level itself? They are looking for a lot of opportunities to implant it for the total development of the society as well as tackling the issues of or global challenges of the modern society. So I have to just give a clear information that what you think of NBIC convergence is entirely different from, it is not different from what I think of NBIC convergence. It is not a difference between thoughts of two levels of extremities or two dimensional approaches. What we think traditionally is orthodoxical and it may be different from modern or heterodoxic view of the convergence, but what I want to say is what really NBIC convergence is entirely different from what the real convergence is. So now we have to point out these flaws and insufficiencies in this convergence issue, even the planning itself. You see, if there is a primary question, it has been asked by somebody, the impact of a subtle tool known as mind, that is written in psychology, the impact of a tangible tool known as brain is read in neurophysiology, neuropsychiatry, neurochemistry, neurolinguistics, neuroprosthetics, neurobiology, innumerable sciences are there with various affiliations to brain studies. If mind is read in psychology and brain is read in neurology, then what is the use of cognitive science which is embedded inside which? So the process of thought, there is a school of thinking that the thought emanates from mind. Mind is a subtle tool and brain is the servant of mind. It is the traditional belief of our Indian systems of knowledge, in which they call that mind as a subtle tool which is an internal organ which also activates the brain. But according to modern neurology or even the latest computational neurosciences, they see that each and every response of what we call mind and its impact is depicted only by a neural process. So this type of brain studies by neurology as well as mind studies by psychology, how they can be related to cognitive sciences. Cognitive sciences is a wider area which covers all tools. So interdisciplinary studies between neurology and psychology is neuropsychology, but they are entirely different from each other. They are interdisciplinary. Likewise, cognitive science that deals with different dimensional approaches of the concepts of cognition. Cognition is of different types, and it will take a different session to explain cognition itself. Cognition starts from awareness. You know that the basic identity of living organisms is consciousness. That is, it is aware of its awareness, and the degree of awareness that differs. For example, microorganisms, they may not be having more awareness. Their awareness of reproduction, their self-structuring, sheltering, self-security mechanisms, those things are very limited. In the more higher species we go, the response of their awareness, it is more and it is sophisticated. In human beings, being the ultramost species standard of organisms, we see different types of cognitions. And even amidst human beings, we are having a lot of people starting from idiots to intellectuals, lazy people to dynamic personalities. This cognition, it reflects due to ecological, biological and various other different factors. Cognition can be defined as the force of a living organism which makes the person to start from awareness till the end of realization or perfection. The wider area that is covered inside, everything is nothing but a manifestation of the so-called cognition. So cognition is a common nomenclature of innumerable standards and grades of behaviors, internal behaviors. These behaviors are known as, for example, memory is a behavior. Perception is a behavior. I see a thing. That is known as perception, number one. I understand the thing. That is known as comprehension. I understand that I understand. That is awareness. I retain the same thing in my mind. That is memory. I design something. I erase something. I jump from one concept to another concept. I determine at a particular status. I am vivified by an experience. I totally am petrified or inert to an experience. These type of internal responses of different kinds and grades are collectively known as cognition. And science, cognitive science, reads about these things. That is, starting from perception, comprehension, memory, direction, design, execution, individual functioning or collective functioning, eco response of individual and individual's response of the eco. All of these studies, there are hundreds of such faculties. So cognition is the study of various grades, stages and manifestations of internal behavior of an organism which is non-biological. It may be based on biological thing, but it is not made up of biological thing. That we will discuss now. So this science is known as cognitive science, and technology is of two types. There are two types of cognition technology. The first type is a application of your cognition in practical implementation or translation of anything you want to achieve is known as cognitive technology. That is Siddhi. We used to call in Sanskrit as Siddhi. I am thinking something, I have a mind to design, I have a mind to pattern, I have a mind to understand static systems, dynamic systems, complex systems, simple systems, intricate system, intrinsic systems, I have a mind. But whatever I formulate in my conceptualization, if I am capable of bringing the same thing into practical implementation, that Siddhi, that practicality as well as dexterity or accomplishment skill is known as cognitive technology. The second type of cognitive technology is instrumental. First type of cognitive technology is internal. For example, if I want to achieve something without the aid of anybody, I can make that. That is known as independent internal cognitive technology. Second thing is external dependent cognitive technology is the interactive studies of cognition with modern technology. Cognition plus modern technology is known as cognitive technology. That is, considering the cognitive psychology, various other forms of waves, phrases, impulses, emotions, balances and imprints of the inner mind, they are read in cognitive psychology. Whatever you are having it inside, Applying the same thing for a common purpose or for an achievement with the help of technology is known as cognitive technology. And this is the technology which is emerging now, and the emergence of the technology as well as the convergence of the technology today we are going to discuss. So this is the real cognitive technology in which the impulses of the mind, they are read with the other properties of modern science and modern technology. What is modern technology? It has storage facilities, it has processing facilities, it has acquisition facilities, it has translation facilities, it has memory facilities, it has communication and distribution facilities, and it has compression facilities by which greater things can be compressed to a micro level, and it has expansion facilities, retrieval facilities, propagation facilities, cryptic facilities, decoding facilities. Innumerable facilities are there in technology which are nothing but the reflections of human technology. The internal technology, whatever we are doing, the same thing is done by technology for mass reach, rapid performance and more precision, simultaneous handling. These four things are the specialties of the technology. You can do the same thing. You can do the same thing which the technology is doing, but the time factor, the energy factor, the risk factor, or the precision or the value factors, these four factors are different from an independent operation from the technical operation. Somebody told that now it is a new technology. It is very funny to imagine that cognitive technology is new, because without having the cognitive skill, how they have founded this nanotechnology, information technology, and biotechnology? Biotechnology, did it evolve by itself? Cognitive technology, we are all late comers to cognitive technology. So there are two ways of approach. A person, that's what I told, the difference between Eastern and Western system of understanding is they should try for basics in West. They will try with basics in the East. That is a major difference, I told in a seminar. We have the ontology, axiology, epistemology and teleology for anything. Now ontology is a new subject. Nobody knows what is ontology. They will ask for apology that they don't know that. So having, that's what I told on that day. 108 differences between East and West. The first difference is Western learning that tries for foundation, whereas Eastern learning that tries with foundation. So cognitive learning, in all Eastern treatises, you start, it will start with pratyaksha, anumana, shabda, nirupana. What is perception? What is analytical probability? What is the theory of proportionate logic, possibilistic logic, intuitionistic logic? What is environmental degradation? And what is environmental inculcation? What is the eco-responsive factor of mind? And what is the psychoanalysis of ecology, socio-psychology, eco-psychology, eco-sociology, eco-physiology, innumerable varieties of these things they have just analyzed in their treatises. That is the greatness of Eastern way of wisdom. But there is a gap between, or a bridge that is to be constructed between these two people. They have done with all the derivatives, seeking for fundamentals. These people being totally packed within the analysis of the primordial factors, further extension towards interpretation towards the modern, contemporary and futuristic trends, that is lacking there. So somebody should build a bridge, a non-controversial bridge or setu between these two traditional and technical sciences. So the purpose of cognitive technology is to understand everything in the real format. And which has come now, see, there are two things. One is understanding things because of their greatness. Understanding things that we think, we produce lot of things. The things produced by us is not the product of our thought. Our thought is different, the product is different. So the product that has enhanced me to think of something by which I can assemble a product. The assembly is a material assembly. So a material assembly has been provoked by a non-material or paramaterial internal organ by which I have contemplated. If my product is great, then that produce has been produced by a basic thought, that must be greater. That was the greater contemplative system of our system, our traditional learning, in which they thought, if I can make anything out of my knowledge, more than the things that I have made, the instinct or that energy that has contributed for all of this making, certainly it should be greater. What is that? So there are some type of deviations that occurred in both of these scientific communities. One community, they thought, yes, I am making everything, I am seeing everything. If I can analyze everything, then instead of considering the things which are subjected to analysis,
the analytical standard of my mind or any tool that must be greater. Let me analyze that. Let me analyze the tool that has facilitated me to analyze everything. So this is Indian knowledge system. Second thing is, I have analyzed lot of things. How I can further analyze them, further go into the unexplored regions of the unfathomable abysmal core of those things, into nanoparticles, femtoparticles, picoparticles. How I can go further, deeper. So this thing are two things. One is known as deeper drill. Second is known as wider drill. So deeper drill, or the deeper cognitive drill of the Indian systems, they started with, if I have understood everything by mind, what is behind the mind? What is behind the intellect? What is behind the consciousness? It is a deeper drill. If I have understood this thing, then what is the next? What is the next? Going in a wider dimension is modern science. So cognitive technology as per modern science is the application of the mind instincts in the form of parallel computation technical exercises with the present technologies available for understanding the structure of operations, number one. Number two, to design the structure of operations and also to verify the operations and to promote them in higher standards or more richer standards. So this is known as cognition technology. And now cognition technology means how to get support from tools, how to get it from technologies, latest inventions. There is one Israeli company which is known as Cognifit. Now latest research, they have made lot of softwares. You know that there are lot of softwares now available for language, speech recognition, for translation, transcription softwares are there. Likewise, cognitive training software. It is known as cognitive training software. And what is the use of that? Like speech recognition software like Dragon and other things, they, when applied with the persons, if you are operating that, you have to give the inputs. Then it will easily evaluate whatever the gurus they were doing there. Now it is done by softwares. An acharya, a spiritual preceptor, or a capable teacher, instructor, he should evaluate. Perhaps he don't know how to evaluate, as he has not been evaluated at the time of his instruction. So now this thing is not there. So it is customized. Cognifit software is a customized software. Whenever just speech recognition customized software is there, if you start applying, it will ask for a lot of personalized inputs, that is known as cognitive details. What is your nutritional value and what is your physical status? What is your vulnerability to various other environmental disasters and congestions? What is the status of your memory? What is the status of your repatriation? What is your shock absorption level? What is your mind suspension level? What is your sturdity? What is your robust way of thinking? How strong is your cognitive construction? All of these intellectual details are taken as inputs. Then, based on these inputs, it bifurcates your caliber into efficiency and deficiency. There are three things by which you understand things, that is known as acumen. By which you have understood things and beginning to do, that is known as caliber. By which you are going to do something with an intention, that is known as aptitude. So the intentional dimension is known as aptitude. The eligibility dimension is known as acumen. And a person's status of mastery or capability to perform is known as caliber. So it totally trifurcates the capability of the person's efficiency, deficiency, marks are very much put, and it guides the person to go into various methods of learning, understanding things. Whatever it may be, IT, BT or NT, whatever it may be, there are five common struggles. One is a person's attraction or fascination to the concept. I am studying NT, I am in IT. So this thing is something known as fascination. This fascination, without proper tools for understanding, that is learning ability. So based on the opportunities for earning ability, without developing learning ability, most of the people are allured towards various methodologies of studies. So irrespective of the faculties, number one, learning ability. Number two, short-term memory and long-term memory. Both are gifts of God, are gifts of the brain. Wherever some melancholy happens in your life, it should be eroded because of short-term memory. If everything is forgotten, you cannot achieve in knowledge. If everything is remembered, then you will struggle in your life. So both of the memories are sides of the same coin. Unfortunately, all the unwanted things are there in the long-term cabin, and the baggage of your education has been put wrongly in the short-term thing. So learning ability, memory, mastery, gradual updation and upgradation of one's own thing. Knowledge should not be stagnant, it should be upgraded. Number four. Number fifth, I always used to say rejoiceable. You must feel relaxed. Whenever you read, you must not be seen as if you are coming from some war. Yes. Knowledge is a very convivial relation between the syllabus and a student, a master and a student, a system and a student. It is not a battle between two enemies. So, this, the same software, Cognifit, is very essential for all T's. Not only IT, BT, NT. All technologies are even starting from a student, it is very much essential for it gives you learning ability, memory power, that is retention, mastery of a faculty, continuous capability of upgradation of things. If you are not, if your intellect is not growing, the syllabus will be growing. The syllabus will be pretty much going, and you will be stagnant or you will be either put into degradation. Then how you can manage that? The fifth thing is relaxable, relaxed way of learning in which we enjoy. Instead of bibliomania or system mania, instead of phobia, we will develop bibliomania and system mania instead of phobia. So these five things are supplied by Cognifit. Now what we want to say is, Cognifit is a company and these people, they have developed that. That is Shlomo Brzeznitz. He is a very great scientist. Shlomo Brzeznitz. He has developed this software and he has understood what is the nature of cognodecline. Cognodecline, the problems of cognitive technology, he has understood and he has developed. What here I want to say is, we have to establish a research institute that we can give through human sources or interdisciplinary sources of our own education or introspective internal management sources, which should be replaced for the software by which we can get the same benefits. And I want to put it once more so that it will be really understood. Whatever we are getting through a software, we have to try to get the same thing from other three sources. One, an introspective way of learning by self-appraisal or by self-survival or by self-striving. Number two, as a beneficent shower of spiritual or intellectual guidance and transformation given by a person or a personality. Number two. Number three, by means of adapting the same interdisciplinary ways of systems. So we must get this from the education theory, number one. If you get it from the system of education, that is number one. If you develop by your own enthusiasm and what we call as persistent curiosity and hard work or diligence, that is number two. If you get from a human source like instructor, preacher, teacher, tutor, guide. So we have to balance, it is not the way of life. To get food, to get love, to get affection, to get care, to get knowledge, everything. If there is a software, then what is the purpose of human interrelations? Now there is a recent research going on, very dangerous research in convergence. They are saying that you abolish all teachers. There is no necessity for teachers. Somebody is appreciating that. Out of their experience, it is just entry, I think. So what they say is, the more attractive tools are computer learning, multimedia presentation, virtual reality, virtual presentation, all of these things are more enjoyable and attractive. And how long the person can see the face of, intolerably can see the face of the same teacher for a single year. It is not the process. So there are two locks. Inside the student, relishability of a master, to understand and enjoy the greatness of a master is a different skill. That particular enzyme has been sealed inside you. If it is open, you can enjoy the master. And you can see novelty each and every day from the same master. The master may be same, and he cannot decorate as if there is multimedia presentation or a fashion show. He cannot make different dress, and he cannot create some sort of attraction which is by external embellishment and other things. He cannot do that. But still, there is a type of craving, there is a type of instinct in all students, number one. If that particular instinct is properly driven by a sanskara, by an imprint or by proper methodology of care, certainly each and every day the teacher will be appearing new, enjoyable, relishable, worthy of respect. Likewise, the teacher is also having an enzyme by which he evinces his novelty, his greatness, his compassion, his erudition, his perspicacity, his embraceability, his adaptability, accessibility, approachability, everything. That seriousness also lacked for the teachers. So neither the teachers are capable of revealing their greatness and novelty, nor the students are in the position to understand the novelty and greatness, which has resulted in the recent research where you install computers, virtual labs, and teleconferencing e-learning systems in the place of all masters, and no masters are required at all. So what I want to say is, instead of this CogniFit, the software, human relations, see, interrelations between humans of various kind, like Acharya Shishya, that is the disciple and the master, husband and wife, children. See, if you have everything in your bank and if you are caretaking houses and old age homes, then it totally, you abolish either your parents or parents abolish their children. So any provisions like old age homes, like orphanages, like 24 hours busy bee works and part-time jobs, abroad settlement, total isolation, destitute, innumerable things are there. Development of technology, now it is collapsing the inter-social network. If the inter-social network on domestic, social, academic and professional status is collapsed, then the Prathama Sutra or the fundamental string of the superstring theory, which is just holding this world, that will lose its balance. That will result in production of cyborgs. So we have to be careful that only relations, these things are supportive tools, only relations can build human to human relations, human to para-human relations, and human to subhuman relations. This interrelativity and interaction, that is going to contribute much, without which we cannot get anything at all. So four major divisions are there in cognitive technology. One is cognitive design, second is cognitive development, third is cognitive decline, and fourth is cognitive decision or dedication. So what is the cognitive design? I already told what is cognitive design. Starting from awareness, you are seeing things, distribution you are doing, and information storage you are doing. Whatever you do through your internal tools, whenever and wherever, it is known as contextual emergence. It is known as contextual emergence. When somebody wants to cook, first they are going to shop for purchase something. That is that context. After purchasing, they are cleaning. That is that context. So it is a process. It is a never-ending process. So in the processing of a person's zeal to do and achieve things, first they think, then they do and they achieve. Between doing and achievement, there are gaps. There may be failures, there may be trial and errors. Even after achievement, there is verification, there is re-achievement, there is more achievement, there is multi-productivity in achievement. So it is a never-ending journey in all people. So this cognition technology will have its impact on four members of the society. Number one, see, a person who has created a new machine, he has also created from his brain. A person who is engineering and making the same machine by tool devising methods, he is also doing with the same brain. A person who is manufacturing, distributing, he is also doing with the same brain. A person operating, he is also doing with the same brain. A person who is just assembling and coming for a repair, he is also doing with that thing. And a person who is selling, he is also doing that with the same brain. That is a commercial brain. And a person who markets products, he is also doing with that. So, commercial manufacturing, marketing, innovation, creativity, adaptivity, operation, everything is done by the same brain, by the different status. If there is a machine produced, the machine has a standard. You say that MB RAM, then what is the memory, what is the hard disk status? You are just mentioning that. But human being, there is no specific such status at all. He has to equip himself to the status. So what the cognitive imbalance, it is known as cognitive imbalance. There is no cognitive equilibrium in the society. Whereas in mechanisms, on the basis of their power, for example, in motors we are having horsepowers, and electrical bulb like things we are having amps and volts and other things. We have measurements for all of these things. In human beings, we have no standard at all. It is being brought by exercises. There are two types of exercises. I have already told approach and access. Now, the same exercises. Those people, those who are having cognitive imbalance or deficit, they have to approach for a lot of techniques. So instead of managing themselves with proper way of manipulating their inherent knowledge, just giving more burden will result in cognitive loss or cognitive crookedness. Most of the people, in most of the companies, even in education, also in profession, they are not given the tools for enjoying or tools for disintegrating the syllabi or the stuff. But further, they have been coercively loaded with lot of stipulations like examination, mark, certification, grade. All of these things are compelling people to do that. And due to this compulsion, being driven by a compulsion, they are doing all of these things. It will result in cognitive loss. And this cognitive loss will also result in cognitive crookedness, and it will be very conspicuous after 3 generations. Now you cannot see that. This behavior will be implanted genetically and it will be transmitted. After 3 generations, nobody can, even if you ask their name, they have to look at a machine, press the buttons and they will say. So they will become like absent-minded professors, totally de-socialized animals or anti-socialized animals. I'm not joking. It is the danger of mechanical evolution. It is going to happen. Now most of the people, senior people, they are all 40% that they won't accept. 40% all senior research people, they are having lot of mechanical impulses inside. And upcoming people, they are having 20%. And the forthcoming people, they will be starting with this 20, 25 and they will reach the zenith after 3 generations. Really, I'm not joking. So, this type of cognitive decline, it will be in different things. Knowledge itself is a burden and it is a problem if the knowledge is not self-efficient. Knowledge that is emanates from you, self-efficient knowledge, is not dangerous and it is productive. Knowledge that is dependent, supportive knowledge is entirely different from external dominance. Having support of a computer is different from having the domination of the computer. So this type of domination from the external sides, that will result in lot of problems. The problems are of different grades. Number one, even if you have a small memory loss, it is known as oblivion. If I forget something, for example, somebody, if they forget some lessons which they have read yesterday, that is oblivion. They have forgotten their mother, father, house address, everything. That is amnesia, that is different. So different types of behaviors, extremities are there. And then somebody, they are having some hysteric emulsion or some volcanic eruption of hysteria or hypertension. That is different. If the same thing is in a higher extreme degree, then it becomes schizophrenia or aggressive schizophrenia, it becomes. So different type of behavior, even lack of memory in Alzheimer's disease, now they are doing a lot of researches on that. Most of the Europeans, we are knowing only one side of the European community, American community. That baseless way and meaningless way of living and living beyond the means, which I told on that global economic disaster lecture, and also hyperactive in hypersensational issues without cognitive balance, that has made most of the people are subjected to loss of memory, eroded memory, unorganized memory, undisciplined memory and crooked memory and operations. It is more in the West. And we are following, the West is being followed by the East. Now we are developing a lot of MNCs in memory loss, in memory eruptions and crooked memories. We are developing multinational status in that multinational competition, MNC, that is not a company, multinational competition with those people. Really we are having these problems. Then, what are the 4 approaches to cognitive technology? Number one, biocognitive technology. Second thing is psychocognitive technology. Third thing is neurocognitive technology. Fourth thing is ecocognitive technology. Biocognitive is, they are considering that the biological process, that is the signals, the instincts and emotion transmissions that happen between various parts of the bodies, like pseudocellular organisms, cells, cell membranes, tissues, organ-specific, organism-specific, all of these things are having a wider internet or a network of communications or network of passing informations in the form of alert, alarm, need, urgency, emergency, requirement, mutuality, partnership, parallelism and collateralism. So these things are the innumerable things that are happening within the body, and this is a base for cognitive development. Somebody say that your biological process that contributes much of your cognitive thinking. So you have to approach from the biological side. Second is neuro. The brain is the major reason for all of the cognitive developments. Approaching from the brain is a type of study. Number three, psycho. The impact of mind in your memory as well as the brain studies, that is very much essential and remarkable. So reading through that mind is psychocognitive. And ecocognitive, you are implanting something on the environment subtly or tangibly, and you are also metamorphosed by means of the circumstantial compulsions or circumstantial intrusions. So the ecological study is essential. And what we are saying is, unless we understand the 4 factors, that is ecology, psychology, biology and neurology, we cannot come to a conclusion in what we call this. So in these 4 major divisions, now we are going to concentrate about the issues as well as the various other possibilities for convergence, if possible, and if it is laudable and productive to the society. Number one, In biology, there is a very major problem. That's what I want to say. 100 special techniques for accelerated learning that we have already developed. I have given a lecture at the Jacobal Garudiya School, the same thing. Basically, there must be a tool specification for that. I am having a talent of playing a tabla. If the instrument is not cooperating, how can I evince my talents? So, even though consciousness is having the capability of getting memory, everything, etc., memory is given only by consciousness. For even that, the productive tools and manifestation tools, they must be perfect. If the originator is perfect, if the manifester or the channel is imperfect, then there cannot be the perfection in this reality or in practical usage. So, apart from the instructor or the producer or the primogenitor, the channel or the medium and various other connective tools, they must also be in precision and order. Just as I've already told, if the strings are not there, and if the strings are imbalanced, if the elasticity is abnormal, and if it is so loose, or if the person is physically weak or mentally imbalanced, the talents cannot evince its nature. Manifestation of talents is only possibly productive by means of the cooperative or federal effort of all precise tools for the function. Likewise, there are four things which I want to say. First is blood supply. If there is no proper blood supply to the neurons, neurons, they imbibe more subtle blood energy than other parts of the body. As they are having parabiological functions, they get into more blood. So if blood is not supplied, there are two things. If something is not supplied, it can do something insufficiently. But here, regarding the neurons, if blood is not supplied properly, it will not be insufficient, it will be totally inactive. So, Shirasasana and also taking lot of exercises which are concerned with the Kapala, and also subsidization of Kapala Ushna by Shirasnana, what we call, and also exercises of Medha, in which by the skull or the Brahmarandra is more concentrated in our traditional mystic exercises, is based on more blood infusion. It is not dangerous infusion of more blood. It is a reasonable, comparatively more infusion of blood, which will make neurons more alive. That is very much essential. Second thing is dendrite. Certainly somebody in the neurobiology, they must have heard about dendrite. What is dendrite? Dendrite is a typically projected branch of the same neurons. And it understands where energy is required and how much this energy is required. So whenever there is a deficiency in the body, but it's known as challenge. What is it known as? Cognitive challenge. I am asking you your name. I am asking you your name. You can immediately say without fail. So because that is in the superficial or the superficial status of your body. That is your knowledge body. It will be in the superficial status. If I am asking a difficult question in life, law of conservation of momentum, immediately you have, it is a challenge before you. So asking something for which you have to concentrate, and asking for instantaneous production, asking for logical explanation, asking for deepening the same root, asking for producing the same thing in a different language, asking for producing something in a debate, these are all the various types of challenges. Dialectic challenge, debate challenge, deep challenge, instantaneous challenge, multifaceted challenge, there are five types of challenges to cognitive drill. So whenever I am asking you, then immediately you require more things. It is possible only by dendrites. Dendrites are the branch projections of the same neurons which supply you more power, by means of which you can enhance your status of cognitive level, by which you can answer those things. It is also biological, dendrite. The third thing is, you must have heard of nerve growth factor. It is very essential, nerve growth factor. Nerve growth factor that supplies you, wherever you are having a particle deficiency, that supplies you with additional energy, by means of which the deficiency of your brain function can be removed easily. Then fourth thing, regeneration of brain cells or neurons. New cells are formed in the brains. And there must be a continuity. For example, you know that cells are born and they die. And qualitative cells must be there. Quantitatively sufficient cells must be there in the brain, and if there is any quantitative or qualitative loss, then there will be lack of continuity. So whatever you have done before, you cannot easily bring into practical usage. So order of performance and order or coherent order of thinking and analysis will not be there. So if I am talking here about a subject like a taila dhara, like the fall of the incessant shower of oil in which you cannot see the gap, in which the speedy rotation of this fan, it will make the blades invisible, like that the speedy, that is the accelerated presence of orderliness without a gap, is the work of the cognitive biological skill. It is possible only by blood supply, by means of getting more dendrites, and also by getting lot of new generations of cells. And fourth thing is by the nerve control factor or nerve growth factor. So these four things are very essential. And what is the problem? Why I am stating these things? See, if a person is studying something more or something deep, I have given five challenges. If somebody is taking a challenging task, certainly they require, they demand more energy. For example, somebody asked me that they are very much having lot of troubles in the office, lot of tension in the office. I asked the designation. They told that they are some managing director or general manager. Then I told, you become a pune, you will be having lesser pay and lesser tension. So if the people who are studying about the information processing is not easy. These IT, NT, BT are cognitive challenges. Why I am telling this is, these three systems of education, they are cognitive challenges before you. Because studying about the fundamentals, biotechnology is not easy. To understand even normal physiology and anatomy, we have to suffer. To understand chromosomal behavior, intergenal behavior, genealogy, genome mapping, intergenial analysis, all of these things require a lot of subtle studies. Information processing is a very great challenge before us. And nanotechnology is the greatest challenge. So understanding about subtlety of matter, understanding about subtlety of life, understanding about subtlety of efficacy, these things are greater challenges. Certainly if a person is not having CT balance, he will not have NT, IT and BT balance at all. Because it is a cognitive load, it is a cognitive challenge. So this blood as well as nerve growth factor, as well as more cells if they are produced. The cells are having two great qualities. According to our Shastras, they say Sandhi and Sangraha. They produce new cells. It is a very great, wonderful behavior of the brain. Whenever cells are going to fade or die, immediately the hippocampus of the brain that produces stem cells. Just as we said, if somebody is lacking for work, somebody is lifting this, then immediately one or two people, they may be lifting it. If it is found to be so Herculean, then somebody watching from there, they will send three or four more people so that it can be easily lifted. This is just a casual social response and behavior which we are seeing. Likewise, if we are trying to do something more than that, the hippocampus of our brain, they secrete stem cells. The stem cells immediately, they go and communicate with the already existing struggling cells. That communication is known as Sandhi. Then immediately, within a fraction of a nanosecond, it imbibes all the information. It imbibes all the information. There is no interface at all. It is interface of similarity. It is interface of common governance. There are two interfaces. What is similarity? It is the same neuron which has been emanated from the hippocampus, which is very identical towards the structure and function of the other one. That is similarity interface. Both of them are secreted by a common governance force. By this thing, if it touches, just by a touch theory, immediately it imbibes all the information since its birth that has been embedded inside that cell. That is known as Sangraha. So these four principles are governed by genetic factors, your food habits, your physical habits, as well as it is included in your medical history. What are all the drugs that you have taken? What are all the injections that you have advocated? Sedatives, somnolizers, drowsifiers, heavy doses of antibiotics, any intra-intestinal surgery for your mother. All of these factors are very essential for preparing the balance sheet of the cognitive ability of a person. Who is doing that now? Unless a person does this, it is very unimaginable. We can read CT, IT, BT and NT only in papers. So, this blood supply, as well as the other biological things I have now explained, they require a medical approach. So, biotechnology must not be only a medical study, but also the person must be medically studied so that he can be qualified to get into medical study. And information technology is not only studying the information for technology, studying about the process of the real information by which he can get the technology inside, that internal information technology must also be studied. The nano level of processing of a person's knowledge and enthusiasm into practical vision must be studied before studying that nanotechnology. Real IT, BT and NT is located inside, without developing which external education that gives no meaning except some interim benefits like salary, promotion, transfer, etc. Then there are some exercises. There was a research conducted by some research institutes in which they say that you must be continuously active. What they say, in order to keep your brain alive, active and free from the hazards of loss of memory or crooked memory or anything, you must be continuously active. And according to me, up to my knowledge, only terrorists are active 24 hours a day. And I have never seen some productive personality being active. So we are also active, we are doing a lot of things, but unsystematically. Number one, there are a lot of games like billiards, polo, golf and other things. They are all white collar exercises. They don't have any utility at all. That is a status symbol. And number two, because it is a status symbol, if you are in a cosmopolitan society, if you say that you don't know billiard, you will be just look like a lizard. And second exercises like swimming, running, jogging. You have been seeing a lot of people running in the early mornings. Hardly distinguishable from pickpocketers or victimizers. It happened at Coimbatore when hundreds of people, they have been just moving in these jogging exercises in the early morning in the race course road. And two great pickpockets with gold and jewels, they are also running with them. Hardly distinguishable. I don't know the reason whether the pickpockets are looking like those highly respectable persons or the respectable communities looking like pickpockets. I don't know why they are hardly distinguishable in that crowd. So these type of exercises, they activate only the body. Running, swimming and jogging, they activate only the body. They are second status exercises. Third status exercises, they say, like chess, like Sudoku, everybody you will be seeing in most of the plays I have seen. While traveling, everybody is busy in writing numbers. Even if they have maintained their accounts very properly like that, they would have succeeded in the concentration that they have, giving with Sudoku and word power, crossword puzzle. These type of exercises, they say that they are in narrow band. In recent research, what they are told, these type of exercises and mastery in chess and mathematical puzzles and crossword puzzles, they are in narrow band. They are not having multifaceted covering. For example, anybody playing chess, they can understand mathematics and logics, but they have to apply, na? But just before mathematics session or lesson or workshop or examination, 2 hours, if you play chess and come in, sit inside, what you can do? It gives you a provision. Because there is a chessboard. Chessboard includes 5 skills. One is attention. Attention is of 2 types. You are attentive towards your movements as well as the movements of the opponent, and you are trying to build an interrelativity as well as position analytical understanding between both of our movements. So, personal understanding, opponential understanding and interrelative study and challenge analysis is there. And number two, it gives you lack of patience. To play in chess, you cannot do that. Carrom board, somebody asked me, what is carrom board and what are all they planning to do? They are just a newcomer. Then they told that they have to make all the coins to fall in the pits. It is very simple. You can just you can just invert the board and everything will fall. Why they are playing like that? But there should be an order. There is a proper way, and there should be patience. So chess gives you patience, and applying these qualities in mathematics or in logics, that will give you benefit. So what they told is there are a lot of white collar exercises, which is just a social prestige. Physical exercises, they do not contribute for cognitive development. Whatever you develop as skill developing, like mathematical puzzle, word puzzle and chess, they are insufficient. So now this Cogni drill or this Cogni tip or this Cogni beneficial systems that we now recently developed, they are told that whatever you have in the society in the form of exercises are insufficient. Or those things are imbecile to develop the demand. Either to develop an inner demand or to meet an outer demand. Yes, I should develop my knowledge. It is my inner demand. Nobody is compelling me. The office is saying we have to finish these things within 5 days. That is the target and time fixation, that is an external demand. Whether we are inner or external demand, that should be met by a specialized cognitive drill by which, according to them, there is no exercise at all, according to Western science, to develop the necessitative level of cognitive skill, there is no exercise available. But it is not so. We have to presume in either, we cannot write it in neurobiology or neuropsychology, but we can write it in some departments of mystics or some department of what we call consciousness technology. In that faculty, we can bring 10 exercises, 10 different exercises for meeting all cognitive demands that are existing and emerging or about to come or not even in the plan of conceptive thinking of humankind. So 10 exercises we can develop. Whatever we are having, avritti, shrinkala, ekadhyana, uchcharana, anuchcharana, these type of traditional practices, 10 things certainly we have to address in a seminar and immediately print it and give it to people, whether they use or not, that is a secondary thing. So according to Western science, cognitive fitness is possible only by a new designing of a software which can give you cognitive training. That is the conclusion, that is the 2009 January 12th conclusion of the Western community. If you want to meet the demand, if you want to meet the emerging demands, if you want to be highly fitful, whatever that you have now is totally not going to come for rescue. So the only way is to have a software for assistance. Now they have made a software, Drive Fit software. It is used in UK, USA, Poland, Finland, all more major countries they are using. It is a Drive Fit software. It is for driving. What a great thing. Huh? Driving is a common thing. Now cooking, Cook Fit software. And taking care of pets, Pet Fit software. Taking care of your children, Child Fit software. Whatever that was there in your inheritance, whatever that was there as a product of your civilization, whatever that was there as a product of your collective existence and iterative behavior, now everything is coming in the form of software. Is it a development or underdevelopment? Can you say with conscience? This Drive Fit consciousness, they have given lot of things. That is ambidexterity, to maintain both the legs in the same way, to maintain both the legs in a different way, up and low position, low and up position, to simultaneously press something, that is ambidextrous. Unidextrous is just pressing the clutch and releasing the brake. Then releasing the accelerator and pressing the brake. This we are doing without any software. What we want is care and vigilance. Is there any software for care and vigilance? Instead of developing care and vigilance, then that is optical vigilance. Optical vigilance is understanding rain, snow, mist, then glacier, then rock slide, mud slide, then road, then transportation, then congestion, then vehicle collisions, then possibility of moving in narrow lanes, then tackling, overtaking, all of these things are quite known to people. They cannot write it in order. The software has written it in order. Some idiot, they should have taken some sort of Herculean strain or arduous risk in writing all of these things. So there is a Drive Fit software for which whatever you have to do with your eyes and attention, your hands and eyes operation in steering and road maintenance or road vigilance, and your hands and legs, eyes and legs. So this is what they have made. Whatever I am saying, very simply, they have told it in euphemistic and technical languages. This is not a development at all. Now the recent development is the brain computer. The brain computer interface. Brain computer interface, you mean that, very simple, there are three things. Among the five senses, three senses are knowledge oriented or communication oriented. Audio, visual and speech. The taste and smell, they are not connected with any information or communication technology. They can be communicated, but they cannot communicate. So that is this thing. So that which is communicable, that which communicates are two types of indriyas or sense organs. In which the three things are there meant for recognition. That is audio, visual, speech recognition. Now what they are willing to now make, the recent project, you know that? In latest bioinformatics, they have created an artificial man. Now they are planning to create an artificial man, that is the communication system of a man, now they are planning to get. So in cognition technology, there is cognitive aid. What is cognitive aid? It is supplying tools in which you can have better performance. Cognitive replacement, that is replacement of tools where you just operate, you need not perform something more. It does everything and you are just an operator. Then cognitive rehabilitation. That is a very great thing now. What is it? Cognitive rehabilitation. Whenever there is a cognitive impair, it may be a wild impair or a mild impair. Wherever there is an impair, this cognitive replacement that rehabilitates a person, for example, audio replacement, video replacement, they are based on McGurk's theory or McGurk's model. In which they have understood if the picture is changed, for example, if you change a picture, immediately the auditory response it also changes. If the auditory response is different, then the optical response it also changes. It is used in disabled children, those who are mentally retarded, those who are tetraplegic, those who are having no mobility at all, and also people who are, that is, impaired. Now they are now rejecting that they should not be called as impaired people. Now before that,
special
ability. Yes, special ability. At first they are handicapped people, then physically challenged people, then impaired people. Now they are specially gifted people or people with a special ability or talents. Now to develop some sort of compensation for the lost ability, as soon as we boost the available abilities, there are two things. To compensate the loss, for example, if there is visual loss, then how to create a vision balance of memory, vision projection, dream projection, conversion of audio into a possible methodology of a visualization insight. All of these things are being dealt in handicapped people, mentally retarded people, disabled people, and people those who are having slow processing. Mandamatis, those we used to call in Sanskrit, lot of people are there. See, handicapped persons, they need not be physical. There are a lot of intellectually handicapped people. Those who are having lingophobia, those who cannot master languages. Then arithmophobia, those who are against mathematics. Chemophobia, physiophobia, and biophobia with physics, chemistry. And neurophobia with brain structure. So innumerable things are there. So intellectually handicapped people, they form 81% of the student community. 81% of the people, they are intellectually disabled. So this type of intellectual disabling status, now what the Western world says is, you have to keep a guidance software and you have to get the benefit. There are three problems. When this software will be fully formed? Now it is just for driving. And can we be driving throughout our life without doing any other work? Number one. Number two, if we are doing, that is known as multi-sensory application, multi-sensory perception, multi-dimensional execution. That is the greatness of human brain. Multi-sensory perception, multi-dimensional cognition, multi-executive ability. These things are the greatness of human brain. For each and everything, if you develop a software, then if you conglomerate a great or grandfather software, somebody can become grandfather. So like a grandfather software, if you can bring that, then it is going to happen, number one. Number two, what will be the affordability? If one software for driving is 50 lakhs, then instead of we can get to driving or we can refrain from the driving itself, we can walk better. The third thing is very important, impact analysis. If there is a software, you see already a small mobile with less complex or dynamic action. Mobile does not have lot of complex or lot of dynamic actions. It is just a communication agency. Even using the mail, even using computer, even using a mobile, on normal things, lot of things are predicted that they must be very, that is restricted to use or they should not be used or handled with care. Handled with care has not been written in these things, but they are advising. So if there is a chip that is going to come, or if there is any such software which is going to come, what is the impact of its nature on inherent intelligence of human brain? How it will genetically affect? How it will be physiologically affecting? Certainly it will affect the three major areas. One is the circulatory system, heart, and second is the cognitive system, the central nervous system. Third is the mind and its balance. Certainly we swear, without any understanding, closing our eyes, we can say that such any development of any cognitive additional skill which is developed from a mechanical aid or mechanical source, either it may be an external source or aid, it may be an implantation, transplantation, or your prosthetic connector, whatever it may be, it is going to create that problem. So our greatness is how to create the same thing by means of man, either with the assistance of another capable human being, or to develop the same capability within ourselves and to derive the capability from the present environmental compulsions or contextual emergence. How we can create that? That is the major thing. So coming to the concluding session, that how there can be an system of convergence in which they can get the benefit. What do they call by convergence? Convergence means like synergy, what they call is nanotechnology, information technology, biotechnology and cognitive technology. All of these things, they must totally contribute for the development of a system or a cluster of systems. That is known as convergence. The synergy is what they call. It is a great convergence, and it is going to be the dawn of the future order of science. There is a very great research work done by Dr. William Sims Bainbird, he is called. He has done a research on this convergence. First, there are four orders. Number one is innovative development. What is the use of this convergence for innovative development? Number two, what is the use of this convergence for understanding of life? That is the cell system or the basic life system. What is the usage of these things in understanding the fundamentals of principles or ontology? How this thing can be used? Fourth thing, how it can be used for enhancing science and technology or the cognition and communication technologies now. Number one, how innovative talent is developed. What is the use of these technologies? Number one, nanotechnology, unless the nanoscale or the microscale or the molecular status of objects or particles are understood, we cannot understand the realistic behavior. There are three types of behaviors. One is a basic behavior, and the second is a secondary behavior. Third is a tertiary behavior. Basic behavior that exists at the time of its inherence. Second behavior that comes at the time of growth. Third behavior comes at the time of response. So nano level, I have already delivered a lecture on nanoscience. I told that how nanoparticles, they behave differently. Opaque thing becomes transparent, solid thing is like gold, they become fluid, and aluminium like things, they become some conductors, they become poor conductors, some non-conductors, they become superconductors. So this type of behavioral diversion or aberration in the nature, fluidity, solidity, conductivity, that is evinced in nano levels. So nano level of study, that gives you real innovative studies. And number two, information technology is a very capable technology in which whatever we take in our mind to decide, it is known as a lead. So whenever you imagine, design and draw something inside your mind, you require a very great concentration, attention and a conducive atmosphere. If the same thing is fed to a drawing system like CorelDRAW, AutoCAD, innumerable systems are there. Likewise, if the same design is computer assisted or if it is a software assisted, immediately that leads you. That lessens the time and makes the thing perfect also. So according to this convergence in automation or development of innovation, they say that nano level of study that gives you the clear picture of the nature or the behavior of particles. Using information technology, complex structures and intrinsic values, they can be converted into either logical processing or algorithmic processing by which we can envision it with lesser time and with more impact. And third thing is very important. Now they are now in the process of bioengineering and biomimetics. If you understand the complex basic behavior of life particles, however they behave inside, you can understand innumerable things. Now they have come to the conclusion that number one, you study the behavior of life units, their growth and responses. The same thing if it is mimetically applied with the external inorganic objects, certainly you can get the reality. It is a recent emerging science. It is known as biomimetics. So understanding life systems and understanding the growth, metabolism and processing and eco-response of life systems, that will pave you more way to understand the lifeless matter. So to put it in simple words, if you understand life properly or the life process properly, the lifeless matter can be understood properly. So chetanas, which are having chaitanya, if they are understood, achetanas are very well within the ambit and purview. That is the innovation. And second thing is cell. You see, a cell is whatever we see in the human body, the reason for all functions, that is in the nanoscale. Most of the responsible particles of human existence or organism's existence is in the nano level only. That's why they are now developing bio-nano processors. Bio-nano processors, that is the convergence of three technologies. biotechnology, nanotechnology and info technology. Certainly the person would have invented the same thing by his cognitive technology only. So that is a convergence of all technologies. Now they are developing such things, bio nano processors. Likewise, in information technology also, understanding various things that happens in the human body is possible by virtual projection or virtual reality. By virtual reality, we have demonstrated a software in which a pacemaker, as well as surgery, a great cardiac surgery, as well as a kidney transplantation, everything has been exactly, precisely envisioned, monitored, directed, and supplied and applied by means of a virtual reality projection. So virtual reality is information technology with biotechnology, as well as the basic other technology, cognitive technology, as I have already told, it is implied in all technologies. Virtual reality is an example in cell studies, basic unit of life. And the third thing is how to study the response in foundation of principles. For example, nanotechnology is going to rule in the computer hardware after 10 years. Most of the hardware, most of the devices will be nano devices. We are just first talking about nanoparticles. The particles are to be processed, devised and engineered by tools. The tools will be in the nanoscale level. That is known as nano devices. So it is not about the particle. If the particle itself is unimaginable to human perception, if the device itself is in the nanoscale level, then it is more unintelligible. It is far beyond the human the reach and thought of his conception. So that type of nano processors are going to come and rule. That is the rule of the future of nanotechnology in computer hardwares. And information technology will tackle a very great couplet of problems. One is reliability and security. That is going to be a very major issue that they are going to tackle now. And biotechnology, now they are going to understand the helix complex message and information delivery between various systems. Various networks or sub-networks are recently understood. I told about the nerve processing system and nerve growth factor. Nerve growth factor, I told. Such much of multi-complex connectivity and network is there. Each and every neuron that connects itself with surroundings and forms network. Likewise, millions of neurons, they can create innumerable networks. According to a recent discovery, limited discovery, they say that each and every neuron can maximum form 30,000 networks. Single neuron can form 30,000 networks. Now the complex study, so 30, that's what the Shastra says, the whole world, even if you consider the whole world, its knowledge, the books published, the books which are in research, and the knowledge which is stored in a cognitive skull or base or container, everything can be very commodiously encapsulated in a pinpoint of a human brain. Human brain, not a divine brain, not even a great preceptorial brain or a super transformation brain or a preternatural brain, just a common human brain. So that much of capability is there in these things. Now biotechnology, now with the use of information technology, it has understood the ability of, see, there are two types of ability, manifested ability and absolute ability. If you see manifested ability of human being, most of the people will be zeros. But the absolute ability within each and every human being makes him a hero. Each and everybody, they are having their absolute ability, which must be provided by either circumstances for self-trial or by a special gift. Each and everybody is having that absolute and infinite ability. It is guaranteed. Likewise, there are innumerable such divisions which they are believing that they are yet to come in various other these things. And what I want to conclude here is three major points. One is the possibility of a multi-versatile mastery. The issue of possibility of a multi-versatile mastery. Second thing is cognitive domination. Third thing, traditional exercises for cognifit. So this is what I want to say. Something which they have found out, something which they are struggling to find out, something they will find out and then rule out. These things need not be discussed by us. Something already known need not be discussed. Something that is not known need not be discussed. Something they know but they are going to rule it out one day, we need not discuss. So ruling out all of these three things, now we are coming to these three major issues. Number one, it is cognitive dominance. Whatever we invent and whatever we do in the society, there must be cognitive dominance. If you are having cognitive dominance, what are all the benefits? One is a spiritual benefit. A person who is having cognitive dominance, he will be continued as a human being or a higher human being, or he will be suitable for liberation. A person whose proper structure of cognition is not used, and if he is tamed and enslaved by circumstances or by scientific slavery, it is scientific slavery or technical slavery. By this, if a person moves spiritually, the person is considered to be disqualified, number one. Number two, socially also, more reliability on machines that will rule out, I have been telling this several times, more reliability on this type of machines, except on para-human, collective or multi-magnitude operations, even for small operations. Crossing a person's real cognitive rule as well as a cognitive demand that he has to execute, more relying on machines that will make the innate mechanisms to be totally eroded. First, it will be disused. Second, disused thing will be deactivated. Deactivated thing will be eroded. Eroded thing will not form anthropology. In anthropology, we have seen lot of behavioral changes in mankind. In bioarchaeology of human beings, lot of physical changes are also seen. Some birds having wings, they are not having wings now. Some beings, they did not develop wings, now they are having wings. Lot of people, they are having tails now, which they did not have earlier. Likewise, innumerable physical changes, innumerable behavioral changes due to environment and due to erosion of the genetic lineage that we are seeing in social anthropology, as well as genetic anthropology, as well we are seeing in bioarchaeology. If you study bioarchaeology, you can see how innumerable differences are there. So now if you suppress your intelligence, make it mechanically dependent, it will be disused, deactivated, suppressed, eroded, and that will be totally amputated from the system itself after a few generations. So now we are losing innovativism. Later on, after 3 generations, creativism will not be there. After 9 generations, nobody can operate a computer. Because the more you lose, gradually, see, according to futuristic, it is going to happen. So what we want to say is, the Shastras, they emphasize on cognitive ability. You must use more your intelligence. The previous systems used more intelligence. More intelligence without the intervention of tools is impractical now. There are 2 dangers. We cannot replace the machines by our intelligence now. Thinking to replace the intelligence by machines is idiocy. And thinking to replace the human brain by machines is lunatism. There must be a reasonable dimension in which they can coexist like husband and wife. Both the mechanical intelligence as well as the man and his intelligence, they can coincide, they can correlate, not collide with each other, creating the loss of the other at the pretext of development of something. That is very much essential in this convergence. And finally, to say, what are the traditional systems for developing knowledge? If a person is sent before a machine or mechanical operation, at least 5 years, he must be given a cognitive training. Basic cognitive training for three things. One is learning skills. How to learn anything, whether it is mathematics or science or anything else, how to learn these things, one. Second is specialized skills. How to go for specialized understandings. Third thing is productive or applied skills. How to go for practical or demonstrative skills. At least 5 years, starting from the age, I told about the age of synaptic pruning, wherein by the brain structure, naturally that invites more knowledge. It disintegrates and converts everything into neurons or neuronics, NYX. So it is a message that is very easily imbibed inside the brain, and that happens only in the impressionable age. Yesterday I told that. So a separate system of learning must be introduced in the society where, see, if you are given a machine and also given a compulsion for learning, nobody will be interested in learning at all. If the machine can do anything for you and if it reduces your risk, nobody will be interested in learning. So 5 years, they must be put in a no machine or no technology zone. And they must be given some set of knowledge by which, number one, they can handle themselves. Number two, they can handle other members of the society. They can handle effectively the machines by which they don't lose their personal handling and social handling. And I wish that should happen. And I am free for questions. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.